So what we saw is that our linear model predicts the data as a normal distribution of its variance, whose mean moves along a straight line. Okay, so and for this we don't want to pass our model parameters, but we want to find the parameters we want to fit automatically given our sample data. Okay, so let's do this. Let's draw some samples from a linear function with Gaussian noise, save it, and let's try to reconstruct our original parameters using our linear regression. And for this now we have the generate data function, which generates random data, so data according to our intercept and our slope of size and samples, with added random noise on top of that. So let's do that. Let's look at the data, and let's plot the data actually using the ggplot here, and we see that the relationship between x and y here looks very linear, and we see that these points are somehow seem to be scattered around the line. And when now reconstructing the underlying structure of the data, so in this case our intercept here is 5 and our slope is 2 for this data here, I'm going to show you first of all the manual way how to do that, then the half automatic way using PATSY, and then the fully automatic way using SAS models. First of all, the manual way. What we want to do here is regression. And in regression, we want to minimize the sum of the squared residuals, so the residuals being the distance from the actual scatter points to our fitted curve. Okay, we want to find the parameters that describe the line that minimizes some error function given the points. And given our assumption of normally distributed errors, the error measure being the square of residuals is the correct one. And how can we figure out these parameters? Well, we can figure out using the Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse. The pseudo-inverse is basically these matrix that is the closest to the actual inverse, the inverse of a matrix being the one that if you have A times the inverse of A, you're going to get the matrix with only the ones on the diagonal. And why that is, look at the neuroinformatics lecture, because the first half of the neuroinformatics lecture is only about that. So we're only dealing with the programming side of things, so look at the neuroinformatics lecture, or wait for the neuroinformatics lecture to figure out why. Just believe us here that this Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse is the correct way to do that. Okay, so the takeaway for now is that simple linear models have a closed form solution and therefore do not require numerical optimization, where we have to get closer and closer, but we can simply calculate the perfect regression line given our assumption of normally distributed errors. Okay, so what we're doing using our Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse is we minimize the errors between the points and the line we fit. If you don't know why, never mind, just know that this is the closed form solution. Okay, so let's do that now. Let's make a design matrix that contains this intercept and the slope. So the intercept is always 1 in our design matrix here, and the slope is should be multiplied by x. Okay, so we have a design matrix where we have 2 columns for the intercept and for the slope, and one row for all of our data points. Okay, and now this here is our design matrix. And this we have to take the pseudo-inverse from. And the pseudo-inverse is defined being this, so it's x transpose times x inversed, because this is a quadratic, we can inverse this, times x transpose. As you may remember, you can only inverse square matrices, and this is why we need this pseudo-inverse. Okay, and we can simply calculate that using numpy.linac.inverse. of the transpose here. That is the that gives us the transpose, and this here is a certain special syntactic sugar for the at operator for written from matrices, and this is simply the matrix multiplication. Okay, and this here is the exact same thing as this, and it looks nice. So using np.dnight.inverse, if you're wondering why, because last week you've seen cypy.dnight.inverse, but note that all of the NumPy functions have been subsumed into the cypy namespace, such that all of those functions are available without additionally importing NumPy in cypy. So what cypy simply does, it from NumPy imports everything. So if we're using scipy or numpy here, it doesn't matter much. Actually, the functions are not precisely different. If we want to see what the precise difference is, and some functions have a difference because scipy added some behavior on top of this, keyboard decorators. But we'll look at that here, but generally just know that we can use numpy.dnight.inverse just as well as we can use scipy.dnight.inverse. Alright, and now we calculate the pseudo-inverse.
Oops, I forgot to set intercept and slope here and return the x, but if we now execute this, looks just the same and it works. And we see now that our design matrix makes sense, and we can actually take the pseudo-inverse from that. And the pseudo-inverse has the shape 2, 100. And to get the parameters out of this, we simply take the pseudo inverse times the bivalues, which will give us the original parameters. Keep in mind that our original parameters were 5 and 2. And now the shape is 2, 100 times 101, which will lead to a shape of 2, 1, which contains then these two parameters. And if we now plot these two parameters, it looks rather a good fit. So the red one is the original one that was our data, and the blue one is the fitted one here. And yeah, this looks rather good. So we did find the parameters of the slope and the intercept that could be the underlying one for our data. They're rather close to the original underlying one, but of course, if we simply had data from some experiment, we wouldn't know the original intercept and slope, but we would simply have these scattered plots, and then having these ones here would be a rather good fit. Okay, this is the fully manual way where we have to generate the design matrix ourselves. And then the next step is the half automated way using Patsy. And what the Patsy package does is it simply generates design matrices based on formulas. Where formulas, again, is this stuff from the R word, which we've already seen for ggplot, where we have formulas, so endogenous variables, and then the tilde character, and then the exogenous variables. Where on the left one we have what we want to predict, and on the right side of the tilde we have combination of predictors. Okay, so we again have this R-style syntax for formulas, which in Python we simply embed into a string. So what I want to predict left, from which I want to predict right, so we want to predict endogenous from exogenous. Okay. So inside of this Patsy formula, then we can again, just like we could in ggplot, refer to keys from data frames, variables from the global namespace, some special Patsy functions, as in ggplot we could refer to some special ggplot functions and any valid Python function. Okay, and what we simply now have to do to calculate our design matrix using Patsy is simply we have to call Patsy.dmatrices, and then we want to predict y from x, this is how we read this, given our data. And this then will result in a design matrix object, which is simply a wrapper around a NumPy array with a nice string representation here. And now ones where it returns the design matrix for y as well as x. But now once we have this, we can simply call our pseudo-inverse function again using this design matrix here, matrix multiplication with y, and this will yield the exact same parameters which we got in our completely manual way. So the Patsy way is simply automatically creating the design matrix like this. And then the next step on top of that, and this is the first time where we use the stats models package, is the fully automated way using stats models. So stats models are simply all the model fitting here for us, and additionally calculates a bunch of useful statistics. So in sets models, we simply call, we want to use our standard linear regression, and this goes by the name of OLS, which stands for ordinary squares. It's simply because it's coming originally from another community where it was called ordinary squares. Okay, and the stats module then simply has these models as classes. So we have one class for the ordinary squares method, and if we wanted to have another kind of fit, we could simply exchange this function or this method, this function actually, by another function. Okay, and we use them from the statsmodels.api package. So what we can simply do is then we can fit our ordinarily squares model using the statsmodels.ols, where we tell the design matrix here for y and the design matrix for x. And from the result of that, we call fit. And then the resulting fit object has a method summary, which will return all of this stuff here. So the ordinary squares regression results. We're going to look at a few of these in the remainder of this lecture. But what we see here also is that we have the coefficients for the intercept and for the x. So we have 5.2 and 1.97 here. So these are again the same ones as we figured out using Patsy, our completely manual way. So we can simply extract these from stats models, and this is the easier way. However, for most of these stats models classes, there's even so we now still need the Patsy design matrices, but there's also a way where we don't even need the Patsy design matrices, and this is using the stats models formula API, and this simply omits the step of explicitly having to construct the design matrices for ourselves, and let stats models create them for us. And this is then using the formula API, and there we can simply provide the same syntax that we would have given Patsy, where we say, in stats models, I want to use an ordinarily squares method to predict y from x using my data, and I want to fit this model onto my data, and now give me the summary. And now the summary again contains all of this stuff, where first of all we're only looking at the coefficient and the slope here, and this is what we want to get at. Okay, so having it done the manual way is nice to know how it's done, but for now, so the end result is the same as than doing it in stats models. So the only two lines of code you need yourself are these two lines of code. Okay, and now I have an exercise for you, and that is using this TIFS dataset here, which is in Seaborn, which contains information about how much TIP was given at Westworld visits. And your task is to try to explain the amount of TIP given by a linear model of the total bill of the order. So use one of the methods described above. What parameters can we recover for the offset and for the slope? So you can either do it the manual way, the half-automated way, or the fully automated way. Makes sense to look to understand. It makes sense to try the other two ways, but the fastest way, of course, is the fully automated way. okay, I'm gonna use the easiest way, and that is using the stats models formula API. So fit for the tips dataset equals stats models formula dot ordinary squares, where we want to predict the tips. Oops. Given the total bill using our tips dataset dot fit, and then from this fit tips we want to call summary. And so the parameters for offset and slope here are 0.92 for the offset and 0.105 for the slope. Okay, so now we know how to conveniently fit a linear model using the cool formula syntax and get a big table with lots of numbers with fancy names making us look very professional, but we should rather understand what this means instead of having this big, much professional looking table. And what these values mean, the rest of the lecture is dealing with. But first of all, I want to tell you that it's really, really important to always plot your data. So, the interface of this function, intercept equals 5, slope equals 2, intercept slope. And now let's figure out, using the ordinary least squares method again, our intercept and slope from this, and let's plot it. And now if we plot this, we can simply get that using fit.params.intercept and fit.params.x, which will simply get these two, well, here it's called total bill, not x, but it will get these respective values for this one. And now if we look at this fit, this looks like good fit. However, if we would add a new data point to our data here, so let's look at our data here. So this here is our data. We have a linear space from 0 to 10 here, and we have a more or less increasing slope with random noise here, and the fit looks good. But if we added a new data point here, which has a value of negative 60, and we would again use our ordinary least squares method to fit, and then this here would be the resulting fit. So obviously this looks really bad given the data because of this one value which is an outlier. And you will oftentimes have outliers in your values. If you measured, maybe it was something wrong with your AEG, or maybe it was something wrong with, I don't know, how you present floats or something. And this is why it always makes sense to look at your data as well. So don't rely on these fancy numbers, even if you understand them, but always also plot your data. Another example is here. So if you look at this data here, this has a structure which is not well represented using a linear model. However, it has the same mean standard deviation correlation as a fit for this data would have. And here again, we have the example with the outlier, or here we have many points here and one point here. So these three are situations where your fit is not good, but your mean standard deviation correlation would be just as well as for this one where these fits are all good. Okay, so make sure to plot your data such that you see if it's really much off.